Exterminate! Exterminate! Exterminate!
Nastiest, most evil, most heartless, cruel and cold-blooded of all the Doctor's foes, the Daleks. And therefore, logically, the most phenomenally popular among dedicated fans and general audience alike. The creation of writer Terry Nation, they were actually designed and built by designer Ray Cusick. And of course, I've got Barry Newberry with me too, who did the histories. But Ray, if I can come to you first, what was the brief when you came up with the Dalek?
Well, like a lot of briefs in scripts, very short. Terry Nation said that they hadn't got any legs, basically, and they had an eye on a stalk. I telephoned him just to clarify the situation. And he said, yes, that's it, they don't have any legs. And I agreed, and we started from there.
What was it that gave you the inspiration? Did you see something that you thought, oh, I like the way that moves, I like the way that looks?
No. there were a group of Russian dancers in London at the time, and there was a peasant dance where the girls came out and danced with long skirts, and it looked as though they were on roller skates. Terry Nation had seen that as well, and we both agreed that was quite nice if they could move around without any sort of legs or obvious sort of movement of any sort, hidden wheels, basically.
And did you? Is it true that you saw Pepper Pot and you said that's the shape?
No, totally untrue. Mm-hmm. It's one of those apocryphal stories. It was after I designed the Daleks and I was explaining to the constructor who was going to make them. I invited him to lunch and I was describing the Daleks and I picked up, it could have been the salt pot actually, and I moved it around the table and I said it would move like that.
And that's where it comes from. Did you ever think they would take off in the way they did and still
no.
be popular so
no.
many years later?
No, nobody did.
But here we are, and we are surrounded by Daleks. Barry, now you were in charge of the histories because, of course, at the beginning, Doctor Who used to alternate between the histories and the futuristic stories.
Yes.
And you came up with the human horrors. Tell us about some of those.
Well, it's a bit difficult to tell you about the human horrors because they were just people that one would come in contact normally in life.
But you were
except they were placed
where they
in
were.
His. I didn't imagine where they were. Oh,
the way they were.
The way they were. I didn't. Actually, the way they were was the way costume would present them. I presented the places in which they survived or lived. For instance, the unearthly child was a cave with an inner cave with all their buried. Well, they weren't buried dead. All the bones of their dead. Which presented really quite a problem because having scoured London for all the skeletons that we needed, and I'd put on my prop list rather hopefully 250 skulls.
You didn't get them, I bet.
Well, I did. Anna Mansi was my buyer, and I said, well, if we can't find it, how do we get them? And he'd found some chap in Surrey who had a vacuum forming thing in his garage. And he made them off, we stuck them together with sellotape and painted them.
And it all came right as it always did with Doctor Who. Back to Debs. Mm.
And according to Verity Lambert, I believe, even things like the Marie Celeste mystery and the great historical mysteries of the world were explained by Daleks. One of the most memorable aspects of the Dalek character, of course, was its steely, chilling voice. Now, the man responsible originally is with us. He's Peter Hawkins, an actor best known for his voice. It's been heard on many an advert, and on several puppet shows on children's TV, including the voices of Bill and Ben, the flowerpot men, whose oddle-poddle language Peter devised himself. A bit of a leap of the imagination from the flowerpot men to the Daleks, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
So how did it come about that you started off to do the voice in the first place?
Well, I'd done so many voices up until that time. That was one version. The other version was that somebody phoned up bookings and said, we want somebody who's good at Daleks. And they thought they said dialects.
Dialects. So that's how you got the job.
Yeah.
Brilliant. But you weren't actually inside them, were you?
I wasn't,
originally
no.
They were only about 4 foot tall, weren't they?
Yeah, I was behind the cyclorama with a monitor and a lip mic and a pair of cans, earphones with the director on one and the floor so that I could hear what was happening on the floor and the actors and everything on the other one.
What electronic gadgetry was used?
A ring modulator.
What's that?
Well, I don't know much about electronics, but it did break up the voice a bit. But
oh,
we still
we
did it ourselves, of course. We still grated it and, well, shall I do a bit? A burst?
Go on.
Hello, Debbie. Look at me when I'm talking to you, or you'll be exterminated, exterminated, exterminated!
Of course, they didn't display that much emotion, except the voices did rise.
They rose.
And they got excited.
Yeah, and they got quicker as well.
What characters did you have?
Characters?
Dalek characters.
Oh, well, they all look the same. So when I was doing about three on one occasion, or four, I got them to do them at different pitches, you see. So, bum was down there, very low, and the next bum was there, and there was a terribly high one like that. Sounds not a bit like Norman Wisdom, isn't it?
Not that different from the flower pot men either.
No, except you could understand what they were saying.
And were they all you, all the time? And
what... No, I had David Graham with me quite a lot of the time. But I went to rehearsals, and then David usually came in on the Saturday, and I sort of ginned him up as to what was happening. It was rather difficult once we saw them on a monitor, because when we were rehearsing, they didn't have their tops on. So you could see the boys... Sorry. You could see the boys inside, you see. But when you were behind and looking at a monitor, of course, and they were cutting very quickly, you never really knew which, because they all looked the same. So on rehearsal day, it was rather important to get it all sorted out very quickly.
And I bet you've had a few reminiscences today. Thanks for joining us.
I have indeed.
Sharma.
It must have been something of a nightmare over in the costume department each time a new series of Doctor Who came round, because the TARDIS could find itself literally anywhere, back in time, in any country, forward in time, on any planet. However, did they manage to keep up? With us now is costume designer Patricia Godfrey. Patricia, we've already seen Debbie running around in the old Honor Blackman costume. Now, what's this that I'm in?
That's part of the costume that Wanda Ventham wore for Time and the Rani.
Right, well, this is one of your easier costumes. Now, we've got one here that is a Cyberman. Now, how's something like that put together?
Well, we use specialist costume makers who are more used to making these types of costumes rather than conventional things. And there's a lot of inventive use of tubes and ping pong balls. Anything unusual that one can find in life. The little bubble packing, for instance, the clear plastic stuff, is very effective when it's been sprayed.
Wouldn't something like this get very hot and sweaty?
It's very uncomfortable, yes.
But there's nothing you can do about that. You don't put in special pads inside or something to help the actors along.
They wear a T-shirt underneath, which helps to absorb the perspiration. But, of course, after a long period of time in the studio under the lights, it can get very uncomfortable.
Right. Well, we've got all sorts of exotica here, including this glorious pair of boots here. Now, how are these made?
Well, they are, in fact, cut-down Wellington boots, right. Good old green wellies, which have been sprayed with silver paint. And we found with a lot of the monsters, we did use a lot of derby boot type, heavy-duty, the early Doc Martin boots. And if they're covered in latex texture, you can achieve all sorts of wonderful effects. And it's very cheap, too, and practical.
Because the secret of Doctor Who really is the way that you kind of make something out of nothing, isn't it? I mean, even here, you've got the Peter Davison costume, which you put together. I mean, it's unique, and yet it uses the most kind of simple and obvious day-to-day items.
Absolutely. There's a cricket sweater, an ordinary shirt, which has had the Doctor Who question mark embroidered on it, which makes it totally different, totally unique from anybody else's costume.
And this, what made you put this over?
Well, it's toning the effect with the jacket, which was based on a Victorian frock coat, and it gave the appearance of a cricket outfit.
But these sort of things are quite simple compared to some of the fabrics that you have used. What other fabrics have you used to make items?
For monsters and things like that, we tend to use layers of different fabrics and using rubber guns, latex rubber guns, which, again, you can achieve good squiggly effects on thick felt.
That is beautiful, as indeed are all these costumes here. Patricia, you must be very proud of yourself. I think I'll try these on the way out of the studio. Thanks very much for joining us today. I think I'll try this one too.
Right, yesterday we had our Doctor Who trivia quiz, of course, here in the studio, which JNT failed to win. But now it's your turn at home to join in a quiz. We've got a three-part question for you to answer. Wendy, would you mind reading it for us?
Yes. Name three of the planets visited by the Doctor and his companions in their struggle to foil the Daleks' master plan.
I don't know the answer to that. Thanks, Wendy. Now, the prize is pretty special. We'll make the winner the eighth Doctor Who in our special 31 Who title sequence, and the lucky winner will get their very own copy on video. But there's one more thing we want you to do, Sylvester.
Ah, yes. We want you to write in 25 words or less why you think you should be the eighth Doctor Who. And don't write because the seventh is rubbish.
Yeah, you being the seventh, of course.
Oh, yes, I am.
Right, so send your answers to the Doctor Who quiz, 31 Who, P.O. Box 582, London, SW15 6AR. That's P.O. Box 582, London, SW15 6AR. So, Sylvester, in 25 words or less, tell me why you're Doctor Who.
Why or why I should be the eighth? Yes, it'd be quite good to be the eighth, maybe. I'm tall, dark, handsome. I'd fail. I lie a lot, lie down a lot. I think that's about 12 words. I rest my case.
Mm. Would you have fancied having Wendy as your companion at any stage?
Oh, yes.
Be very careful what you say.
Yes, yes. I remember fancying Wendy when she was a companion.
What companions have you had? How have they differed?
Well, I had Bonnie Langford playing Melanie. She was thin, lots of red hair, and screamed
their
a lot.
Characters.
Oh, sorry. Well, yes. Well, she screamed a lot.
Didn't we all?
Yes. Yeah. You were a screamer, weren't you?
I was a bit, yes.
But then I...
Sophie Aldred.
Sophie Aldred. Well, she doesn't scream so much. She just tries to blow things up. She has a better time, I think, as a companion.
As Ace, yeah. Better. Do you think Ace is a latter-day Zoe, then? Because Zoe started off being this intelligent astrophysicist.
Yeah, I mean, Zoe started off really well, I thought. Well, I don't know. I mean, I just ended up screaming like the rest of them. I don't know why.
Easier for the writers.
I think it's easier for the writers to write for a girl, you know, as opposed to...
What a shame. The opposite
happened with Sophie. She came in and took over from the screamer, and then it was discussed, and I felt quite strongly that my companion shouldn't be like that. She'd be a girl who, travelling with the Doctor through time, would pick up information and knowledge and therefore become a much more knowledgeable human being by the time she's finished.
Mm, indeed.
I mean, it was really nice to actually be clever than the Doctor and be able to...
I don't think being clever than the Doctor is a good idea. But I have to say that I don't think we're going to go that far with Sophie.
No.
Listen, you're going to hate the next thing I've got to ask you to do then.
What?
Give us a scream.
Oh, don't be mad. I haven't screamed for years. No, that's not a scream. I couldn't possibly scream.
Sylvester, it's down to you then.
That's the end of my career.
That's awful.
Well, if you've been wondering how the good Doctor escaped from the path of the lava flow at the end of our last story, The Dominators, stay tuned. All is explained in a special five-part adventure, The Mind Robber, written, apart from episode one, by Crossroads, Compact and Wagoner's Walk creator Peter Ling. And you're in for a highly inventive story. The Doctor's companion, Jamie, normally played by Frazer Hines, doesn't appear in episodes 2 and 3, but is played by another actor, Hamish Wilson. The reason? Frazer developed a bout of chickenpox, but to keep it in the family, Hamish is Frazer's cousin.
Hello again. Now we should be within communication distance of one of the Doctor's companions, but which one? If I press these buttons like Sharma did, what did you do? Now let's see who it is. And it's Frazer Hines making his return. Welcome back to 31 Who, Frazer. Tell me, what was the favourite story?
I think actually the War Games were probably my favourite, because we got a lot of... I got to ride a horse for a start, which was great fun, galloping on the stunt horse and diving off and rolling Peter Diamond, who... Peter Diamond did my sort of first Doctor Who. We had a sword fight, and he sort of... which side? Nicked me somewhere with a sword. And I'd killed him so many times in Doctor Who. And it was great to get my own back, diving on him. And he ended up calling his first son Frazer, because he said, you've killed me so many times, I'm going to be reminded every time that boy walks in the kitchen. But that was a favourite one of mine, because also we had the Roman soldiers, we had the First World War. I got to sort of have the rifle and fire a few guns. And also I had a lovely comedy scene where Jamie had to pretend to be this sort of big war hero with a khaki cap on, the bandolier of bullets, and supposed to be a big sort of tough leader, trying to copy the Mexican bandit leader. So I had a lot of humour in that as well for James. So I think that was my favourite.
You and Patrick Troughton were great practical jokers, weren't you, of course? Tell us a bit about that.
We were, particularly to our female companions. A couple of stories. I remember we were filming on Margate Beach, and there was all this sort of foam all along the beach. And Patrick and Debbie and I had to sort of get out this rubber dinghy and walk through it. Well, they'd set all this foam up, so we couldn't rehearse it, because every time you walked through it, it was dispersed. So the director said, let's go straight for a take. So Debbie was in the middle of us. And Patrick and I had this sort of telepathy. He could look at me and I could look at him, and we both knew what the other person was thinking. And we started to walk through this foam, and I looked at him, he looked at me, and we looked at Debbie, and we just grabbed her and threw her and rolled her in all this foam. She came up, covered up in all this foam, going, you swine, look, you... The director was falling about laughing, and they kept it in.
You rotten luck. But you obviously enjoyed playing Jamie then.
Jamie was great to play, wonderful, because I don't think it needed a lot of work on it at all, because he'd come from 1746, a Highlander, suddenly into this room with lights and electricity. So everything you can see in a room, Jamie had never seen before. So for me, it was so easy, the sort of electric light switch, and what happened there, and who put it. It was a wonderful part.
Thanks very much, Frazer. Now, Sharma.
Now, over the years, many stars have appeared in the Doctor Who series. It was a national institution, and the actors and actresses were delighted to be associated with it. Here's our tribute to them, the Doctor Who Hall of Fame.
Those faces, could you put names to? Just before we embark on the Doctor Who story, The Three Doctors, where William Hartnell, Patrick Troughton and Jon Pertwee are seen together in the same story for the first time, we've time to find out a bit more behind the scenes. First of all, we're joined by two key figures who helped to make that story, the Brigadier, Nicholas Courtney, and the script editor at the time, Terrance Dicks. Terrance, why was it put together?
It was really that it was an anniversary show and we wanted to do something special. And an idea that had come up again and again from fans very often is, why not have all the Doctors appearing together? And so we dismissed it at first, and then suddenly we thought, maybe that's not such a bad idea, and we contacted them all and they all wanted to do it, and that's how it happened.
How did they all get on with each other, though?
Well, William Hartnell, the oldest, only made a kind of quite small appearance because he was not very well and had to be largely pre-filmed. You might say there was a certain rivalry between Patrick Troughton and Jon Pertwee,
yeah.
But which lent a nice kind of edge and tension to the scenes, you know, because they were vying with each other quite a lot, which was fun.
So the Brigadier's role was quite a vital link, wasn't it?
Oh, yes, he was trying to calm those two doctors down who kept on arguing with each other, you know, Pertwee and Troughton. And, of course, the Brigadier was horrified by all this. He'd been used to Patrick Troughton. Then Jon Pertwee came along, and then the two of them together must have blown his mind.
So what happened 10 years later then, in the 20th anniversary, when there were five of them?
The five Doctors. Well, most of my, most of the stuff I did in Five Doctors was with Pat Troughton. By then, the Brigadier was used to the face changing. He just got used to it, and he accepted it.
Just
with
as
great
well,
resignation.
Really, yeah.
Yes, just as well.
Terrence, you actually wrote that one yourself, didn't you, The Five Doctors, the 20th anniversary.
That's right, yeah.
Tell us how about the complexities of writing that sort of a story.
It was very difficult, but of course, you know, you got five leading actors, all of whom, you know, you had to give a good scene and a good line and make them feel that they were really, really important. And of course, you got Peter Davison, who was the current Doctor, who really had to be given a sort of ascendancy. The way I got round it, basically, was by pairing people off so that Nick was mostly with the Patrick Troughton Doctor, and they did their kind of wonderful double act together, you know. And I would pair off a companion and a Doctor. So that really we only had two kind of ensemble scenes, one at the beginning, then they all went off and attacked the problem from different ends, and then we brought them all together for the grand finale, you know, the walk down, as they say in pantomime terms.
Well,
and
we're
Nick said goodbye to them all, didn't he?
Yes, I did indeed. Splendid chaps, all of them.
And we'll be able to see the three Doctors shortly. Thanks for joining us. John.
K-9 became Doctor Who's best canine friend during the Tom Baker era, and he was created by two very experienced Doctor Who writers, David Martin and Bob Baker. Welcome, gentlemen, to 31 Who. Now, perhaps you could tell me how you came to invent this marvellous invention.
We were doing a show called The Invisible Enemy, and as usual, we got into a mess with the scientific explanation of it, so we needed something, well, a stupid scientific explanation of it, so we needed something to get over that thing and to answer all the Doctor's problems. You know, when you have one person, he's got to have somebody to talk to. So this was called Pluto for a long time, knowing that we, you know, Disney wouldn't let us use Pluto. And one night, over a couple of bottles of this and that, K-9 sprang to mind.
Yeah, well, I think the real reason it sprang to mind was that Dave had some rather fine Springer dogs and lost two of them. And I think maybe he wanted an indestructible dog, you know, to create it. And I think this was
Did you ever envisage it would take off in quite the way that it did?
We had no idea at all. We put it in as the companion of Professor Marius in that story. And it was Robert Holmes who rang us after we'd finished the story and said, we'd like to keep him on. Can you rewrite that end of the scene so that he gives him to the Doctor at the end?
Yes.
And that's how it came about.
There then resulted a huge volume of merchandise, and they're related to K-9.
Yes, there was talking canines and badges and goodness knows what.
Jelly babies.
Jelly babies, yes.
Jewelry.
Chocolates.
Jewelry, great. Let's move on to the three Doctors now. Can you tell us anything about the problems of writing for three central characters?
Well, I think as soon as we got the typewriter set up and called them Doctor 1, 2 and 3, it became simple. But when we just kept putting the Doctor down, it did get confusing because we didn't know what was going on.
No, yes. And the biggest
thing,
of course...
thanks to Terrance Dicks.
Yes. The biggest thing, of course, was suddenly we were told in the middle of the whole thing that Hartnell wouldn't be able to appear in it. Yes. And we thought, and now what do we do here? So he appeared in this ball, as we know.
Yes.
Because he, you know, poor old soul was a bit unresponsive.
Still very successful there. Sharma.
Hartnell, the works, we've got them all here because the whole Doctor Who phenomena has spawned a mass of merchandising spin-offs far beyond the usual run-of-the-mill T-shirts and China mugs. We have a fair selection here, and our guide is Doctor Who fan extraordinaire, David Howe. David, you've been collecting for 15 years, is that right?
Yes.
OK, now, there are tons of things here. There are Daleks, there are books, there are mugs, there are everything. And there's this that a lot of us remember from when we were little.
Yes.
Where did you find that, and how much did it cost?
Well, that's a Dalek play suit that was produced in about 65, 66. When it was actually produced, it was actually quite expensive. It cost something like 60 shillings. So what's that? I don't know what that is in real money.
About 3 quid, wasn't
something
it?
Like that, yeah. I picked this one up, and it's absolutely brand new, if such a term can be applied, for about £150.
A mere £150,
yes.
Well, you're certainly onto a winner with Doctor Who. What about this chap here? I think he's worth a bit as well, isn't he?
Yes. That's a particularly nice model Dalek. There's a lot of model Daleks produced. This particular one is one of the original 60s ones. Again, anything from the 60s is expensive because it's hard to find. This one cost me, I think it was 60 quid, but they can go for anything up over 100, whatever.
Gosh. Well, Daleks are not the only thing, of course, that we associate with Doctor Who. Not that underpants are, but here we have a pair with Tom Baker on.
Yes.
Very nice. How much? Age 6 to 8.
Age 6 to 8, yes.
I mean, how do...
Are we allowed to, advertise?
No, no. What, are you selling stuff?
No, no, no.
But do those go down very well?
Well, you wouldn't see me dead wearing them, but...
But many people have been seen
but
alive.
But I presume the chain store that produced them felt there was a market for
absolutely.
Underpants with Tom Baker's face on them.
Congratulations. Congratulations on all this, because it's absolutely fabulous. Back to JNT.
Well, after the break, we have a special four-part story to celebrate the programme's 10th anniversary. It is, as we've already said, written by our guests Bob Baker and Dave Martin and unites the three Doctors to date, Jon Pertwee, Patrick Troughton and William Hartnell, though the latter's contribution was restricted to appearances on the TARDIS screen, as at the time he was quite ill. Katie Manning is the Doctor's female companion, Joe Grant, and the Brigadier, Captain Yates and Sergeant Benton are firmly entrenched as luminaries of the United Nations Intelligence Task Force, UNIT, for whom the Doctor is a scientific advisor. Stay tuned for the three Doctors after the break.
Lunch when pepper pots were slid across the tablecloth, and I pressed up the Daleks were born. Very Cusick said this now. We know it was more complicated than that. Now, where did you get your original ideas from, Ray?
My mouth and mouth frustration, and from my head. All designers get their ideas from their head. This design was supposed to be inspired by pepper pots, so it's a simple thing, and they'd be very easy.
So you sat down and you knew you had to create something that wasn't human and was pretty frightening.
Yes.
Well, was there anything that gave you the idea of that shape?
Yes, the pacing. I approached the whole thing logically. A sense of ergonomics within. I draw an average person sitting down and design the shape to fit around the person sitting down. The idea of a person inside an actor was it was man-powered and would never fail.
As you put the idea of the Dalek together, you also allowed for the fact that there would be a mutant person inside, although we never saw them, is
no,
that right?
No, we never saw the Dalek. It was, as I've often said, it was editorial policy not to show the Dalek, because it was too horrible. It was a horrible mutant. And also to suggest horror, so that it's this wonderful extra dimension of the audience. If you just suggest horror, they will fill in the gaps. And it would be far more horrible than anything you could design.
Well, of course, the Dalek was pretty horrible, but it was put together with just sort of bits and bobs, really. It wasn't some fantastic space-age job, was it?
No, it was done on a very, very small budget. Very small budget. And there were four made, just for a matter of a few hundred pounds.
And what was it, hardboard with a plunger? Or
fiberglass. It was, one was, a mould was made, and four were cast off in fiberglass.
Well, was it really a sink plunger that they used?
It was. Originally, it was going to be nippers, like claws, but we couldn't afford that. So we came up with this idea with a plunger.
Well, it worked. It worked very well indeed. Over now to Debs.
Good job. It wasn't nippers. A sink plunger was bad enough for me. Just how far the Daleks have infected public awareness is illustrated by our next item. You just wait for this. Just about everyone in the country knows them and their threatening tones. So we went out into the streets armed only with a sink plunger, and this is what happened.
Exterminate!
Oh! I am a
Exterminate! Exterminate!
Oh, this is ridiculous. I can't do this!
Now, part of the appeal of Doctor Who is the number of monsters encountered by the Good Doctor and his companions on their adventures. We're all familiar with the Daleks, but just how keen are you on the others? In a recent poll of Doctor Who fans, these are the ones that came out top in a monster top 10.
Plungers were actually down here. Why did they have everyone put them up to their heads earlier on? Now, as we're coming close to the end of our Doctor Who weekend, it's time to return to hear some more thoughts from the series' first producer, Verity Lambert. When I went to see her in her West London office, she talked about those ever-popular Daleks and discussed something dear to the hearts of all of you fans out there, the future for Doctor Who.
They are approaching.
The first time I went down to rehearsal and we had them there and, you know, people were practising in them, everybody wanted to get inside one. All the actors, me, everyone. So I knew immediately that somehow we'd got it right.
Not much room for my legs, but try the top.
We did a Dalek serial where they invaded Earth. And there was a wonderful thing where we were allowed to film on a Sunday with the Daleks outside the House of Parliament. And that was actually quite marvellous, sort of seeing them coming over the bridge, you know, towards the House of Parliament.
Did it change very much after you left?
Perhaps it's become a bit of a parody in the last few years. It doesn't take itself as seriously. And in a way, I think that's a pity, because I think good stories always work. And I suppose if I was... I regret the fact that Doctor Who's become a bit... of a joke.
Are you still happy to be associated with Doctor Who?
Well, I am certainly happy to have been associated with it, absolutely. It's one of the things I've enjoyed most doing. One of the things I look back on with great affection.
Would you ever like to be involved again?
Well, I'd sort of like to have a go at doing it all on film and see what happened then.
Is that a likelihood?
I don't think so.
Now, the Daleks were originally created by Terry Nation. Their chilling cruelty, their robot technology ensured them lasting popularity. Terry Nation, now a Hollywood writer and producer, and the early production team, had no idea the Daleks would become one of the landmark creations of science fiction. Our Los Angeles producer caught up with them.
I had grown up in the cinema, at the front row of the Odeon all my life, practically. And I used to love the, what were then rated H pictures, horror films. And there was the Mummy and the Frankenstein monster and all of those things. And even though I thought they were wonderful, I always knew that the monster was a man dressed up. And so when I came to make my own monster, I wanted to make sure that it was not a man dressed up. And if anything you can do with that, I think, is to take the legs off.
You have destroyed our videoscope and one of our lips.
And you in turn killed the Thal leader in your ambush. You will be responsible for more deaths unless you help these people.
The only interest we have in the Thals is their total extermination.
When I wrote that first block of Dalek episodes, I worked on the assumption that this was take the money and fly like a thief. The show cannot last beyond its original 13. I mean, what a dumb show, I said. And so I killed them off, knowing that there would be no future for these guys. Then I figured, oh, we had to get them back. And I felt a bit like Conan Doyle trying to get Sherlock Holmes back from the Reichenbach Falls. But then it occurred to me that we were moving through time. So what we could have ultimate, what we saw was the ultimate end of the Daleks. And now we could go back and see other things that they had done in time, which justified it for me and I think everybody else. But we finally didn't care too much, you know. I think they were bad. They weren't grey, they weren't nice bits about them, they were bad guys. And I think everybody could relate to that. Doctor Who and the Daleks probably helped science fiction enormously. I mean, science fiction was a dirty word, it was sub-literature at that time. It has introduced kids to good science fiction, who then went on to read the great writers of science fiction. It's now certainly science fiction is a bigger part of our culture than it ever was when we came on the air. So I think it's very valid to say we did make a contribution.
Our principness, our intelligence, and perhaps dangerous. Why not exterminate them?
I have a great pride in the fact that the word is in the dictionary, that I created these creatures, that they still exist. And I suppose everything surprises me, but now it's that they've been a part of my life for so long that I can't think of my career without them.
Well, stay with us now for the second Doctor Who feature film starring Peter Cushing as the Doctor. This film was based on the TV story The Dalek Invasion of Earth and produced by Amicus Films. Roberta Tovey appears again and Bernard Cribbins plays a British policeman who joins the TARDIS crew. Join us after the break for Daleks Invasion Earth 2150 AD.
We've been time-travelling around the early history of Doctor Who for 33 hours now, and that's very nearly all we have for you on this Doctor Who special weekend.
Yes, if you've stuck with us for the entire time, you'll probably need a reminder that this is Earth at the beginning of the last decade in the 20th century. I must say, the high spot for me this weekend was Waris Hussein's story about the monkey that did his business over all the actors. What about you?
Well, Sylvester McCoy made me laugh, but my favourite moment was definitely meeting Elizabeth Sladen, alias Sarah Jane, my favourite companion.
Yeah, she was great. And what about you, Jane?
Well, my favourite moment was seeing that very first story and seeing how this great British institution first started.
And indeed it is a British institution. But we're all agreed that the most startling evidence of Doctor Who's impact on the viewing public was demonstrated by this short video.
Oh, this is ridiculous. I can't do this.
Sadly, our energy banks have nearly lost their power and it's time for us to go. We hope you enjoyed Galaxy's unique Doctor Who weekend and the special features we were able to bring you on 31 Who. So now, it only remains for us to say...
Exterminate! Exterminate! Exterminate!
Thank you.
Well, it's all over, and you won't catch me doing a Dalek impression. I hope you enjoyed our marathon jaunt with the Time Lord. Keep an eye on our galaxy. You may just spot that TARDIS travelling your way again soon. For now, from me, Trish Bertram, and from presentation director and Doctor Who devotee, Simon Dorr, a very good night.